drink the drink. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, some people used to say that they don't drink. Any living soul that does not drink, I don't think you are living. Praise the Lord. So you need to have a drink.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
This morning you are going to dream a dream.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
And your life will be changed by the dream that you will dream.
Amen.
Your life will be driven by the dream that you will dream. Praise God.
Amen.
You know, there is something that gives you a drive in life. And that is dream.
Amen.
Anyone who does not have a dream does not have what pushes him back forward. Anyone that does not have a vision does not have a force. Are you understanding?
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
If you don't understand, you just indicate. If you don't have a dream, you cannot have a force. If you don't have a vision, a dream in this context is also like a vision. If you don't have a vision for your life, if you don't have a dream for your future, you cannot have a drive. It means that you are failed to have what motivates you. When we talk of drive, we are talking of what motivates you. When we talk of drive, we are talking of what instructs you. When we talk of drive, we are talking of what directs you. When we talk of drive, we are talking of what guides you. So there is always a usual and unusual force, a supernatural force that comes to you when you have a dream. When you have a dream, when you have a vision, you realize that there is a force inside you that drives your life, because you will try to employ everything, every factor, every element in order to achieve that dream, to achieve that vision, to accomplish the vision. So any man or woman without vision, any man or woman without dream does not have anything that drives you far. You are driven by your dream. You are driven by your vision. You are driven by your vision. You are driven by your dream. So it's very important for you to have a vision. And a vision requires supernatural focus. So the theme for our message this morning is supernatural focus. Tell someone beside you, supernatural focus. Praise God.
Amen.
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 And in order to run with your dream, you must understand your dream. Are you writing? You must understand your dream, and you must make your vision very clear. You must make your vision very clear. Some people imagine, some people just speculate, and they don't really know what they want. They don't really know what they are out for. So today, you desire this, tomorrow you desire the next thing, and you keep on fluctuating, and you live without vision and dream. So you must understand your dream. When you understand your dream, you will not settle for anything apart from the dream that That's why God told Habakkuk. Let us go to the book of Habakkuk. Habakkuk chapter 2. Habakkuk chapter 2. Are we there? Are we in Habakkuk chapter 2?
Yes.
I'll read from verse 1. I will stand upon my word and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. Verse 2. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie, though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come and it will not tarry. Praise the Lord. And then God told Habakkuk, write the vision. Make it very plain. When your vision becomes very plain, then it will give you a force, it will give you a momentum to run with the vision. Are you understanding? And other people will see your vision and they will begin to run with you. But now, vision need to be birthed. How can you receive a vision? How can you have a dream? A dream or a vision is birthed from the womb of prayer. It's birthed from the womb of prayer. When you are a prayerless Christian, then you are a visionless Christian. That's why Habakkuk said, I will stand upon my watch. In another word, I will pray. Watching means praying. Watching means seeking God in prayers. So Habakkuk says, I will stand upon my watch to see what the Lord will show me. So you see, it is in the room of prayer. It is in the attitude of prayer that you receive a clear vision. The reason why our vision, our dream is dancing, is instable, is fluctuating, is imbalanced, is because it has not been birthed out of prayer. Praise the Lord. So prayer is the womb that gives birth to vision. Prayer is the womb that gives birth to vision. You can never compare with a prayerful Christian. When you watch the life of a prayerful Christian, you watch an organized life. You watch a structured life. Even their day-to-day activities is organized. Because they have a vision, they have a focus. So when prayer gives you a vision, you watch over that vision and you know what to do, the necessary materials required for the accomplishment of that vision. And when you have a vision, you will live what we call patience. When you have a vision, you will learn patience. That's why God told Habakkuk, Habakkuk was saying here, he says, and the Lord answered me in that verse 2 and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables. Make the vision very plain. In another word, understanding your vision and making your vision to become tangible. Tangible is something that can be seen or touched. So that anyone that sees you will know that you have a life of purpose. And they will be able to run with your vision. When you have a vision, you influence your generation does not influence you. When you have a vision, you influence your friend does not influence you. Sometimes we are easily influenced negatively because we don't have a vision. You can never influence a man who has a vision. Because he knows what he is pursuing. He knows what he has seen from the Lord. So he can never allow any negative influence from anybody. So you find people who does not have a vision being influenced. Their life is being run by friends. Their life is being run by family members. So when you have a vision, there is nothing that can discourage you. Not even your situation can discourage you. When you have a vision, there is no circumstance, there is no persecution that can move or displace you. Now I want to show you the life of somebody in the Bible who had a dream. Let's go to the book of Genesis chapter 27. Verse 3, for the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. We have to go to Genesis, but I'm still in Habakkuk now. I'm still in Habakkuk. Go back to Habakkuk. Let me finish there before we go to see this man. When Habakkuk, I'm just in verse 3. Habakkuk, are we there? Praise the Lord. So your vision does not lie. Your vision cannot deceive you. Praise God. And vision talks. Vision speaks. Vision does not lie. So when you have a vision, you have a secure destiny. If you have a vision, you have a secure destiny. Because vision speaks and vision does not lie. So whatever is your vision, be certain that it will come to pass. Praise the Lord. Now, Habakkuk says you might experience some delay. You might experience some hold up. You might meet some red traffic light, but it will surely come to pass.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. It will surely come to pass. It does not lie. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, I want to call on us this morning to have a dream.
Amen.
Because your dream can never lie to you. Your dream can never deceive you. Your dream will speak for your destiny. In Jesus' mighty name. Today, you will have a dream that will change your life around. You will have a dream that will give you a new name. In Jesus' mighty name. Dream does not lie. Dream does not deceive. Now let us see. Go back, let us go to that Genesis and witness or examine the life of this young man who had a dream. And then let us see how he was driven by his dream. Joseph, when Genesis chapter 37, are we there? Genesis 37. Please, I want everybody to open. Everybody.
Are we dead? Genesis chapter 7. If you are dead, let me see your hand up. If you are Genesis chapter 7. So that those who are not yet dead, we can wait for you. Okay, we are all dead. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generation of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wife. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamt a dream, and he told him his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. Now I want you to understand something here. Joseph was with his brethren, and he feared God. In another word, Joseph was always having time with God. So he did not like what his brethren were doing, his brothers were doing. So all the time when they do all those their wrong, all those their atrocities, whenever he comes to his father, he will report them. Then they hated him because of that. But the point I want us to make, I want to bring here is that the fact that they hated Joseph did not stop Joseph from dreaming. That's the fact I want to make. Praise God. So the fact that somebody does not like you does not stop you from having a dream. The fact that the condition is not favorable for you now does not stop you from having a dream. The fact that poverty is beating you now does not stop you from having a dream. So, in a nutshell, your present circumstances cannot stop you from having a dream. So you don't have a reason for not having a vision. Joseph was in the midst of his brethren, hated by his brethren, but yet he could have a dream. Praise the Lord. He could have a dream. He had a dream. In the midst of difficult situation, he could still have a focus. He could still see himself somewhere. Sometimes we grade our life based on the opinion of others. The way people look at you, you just accept. Okay, this is what people say I am, and so I am this. So I cannot be more than this, because everybody knows that this is what I am, this is how I am. Praise the Lord. So you don't look forward. You don't see a bigger future. You don't see a bigger life, because people or situation is saying that this is who you are. Don't allow any situation to limit you.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. I want you to change your level by having a bigger dream.
Yeah.
Because Joseph was keeping the sheep, but he dreamt that as a shepherd boy, people were coming to bow before him. So the fact that he was keeping a sheep did not stop him from having a bigger dream. He knew that he was a shepherd boy, that kings, nations would come to him. Praise the Lord. God bless you, Jesus. Is somebody understanding what I'm teaching? What I'm teaching you is very deep. Huh? The fact that you don't have money now, the Bible says that in Isaiah, it says, kings shall be your blessing fathers. Queens shall be your blessing mothers. Praise God. He said, the nation you don't know shall come to serve you. The nation you don't know, they shall come to serve you. So Joseph was a shepherd boy who has the vision that men, nation will come and bow before him as a shepherd boy, as an errand boy.
said he has a dream. And he told his brethren his dream. He made his dream very plain. Because sometimes when we have a dream, we are afraid to tell people that they will tell us that we are too ambitious. They will tell us that you are just joking. How do you think that is going to be possible? Praise the Lord. Amen. Paul says in 1 Corinthians, he says, we have believed, also we have spoken. So what you believe, you have to speak it. So he was convinced of his dream. Before you write your dream, before you make your vision play, you yourself have to be convinced of it. Praise God. So when Joseph had that dream, he was convinced of that dream. So he called his brethren, and then he was sharing his dream to his brethren. I love Joseph, and I love his courage. But let us, we are in verse 4. And when his brethren saw that their father loves him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak this dream unto him. And Joseph dreamt a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, yea, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed, for behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright, and behold, your sheaf stood round about, and made obeisance to my sheaf. Praise God. Then he bring him, he said, come and listen to this dream. He said, this dream, we were binding sheaf, and my own sheaf rose above your own, and you came and bowed and made obeisance, and pay homage, respect before me. And he was calling them to come and hear. Praise God. After that, they say, and his brethren said unto him, shall thou indeed reign over us? Or shall thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his vision. Who told you that people will love you when you have a vision? Who told you that it's everybody who will come to support your vision? Amen. So you don't need to be despair because of what you are going through. Because what you are going through is because of your dream. It's because of your vision. Praise the Lord. The bigger your vision, the bigger your trials, the bigger your temptation. The bigger your vision, the bigger your trials, the bigger your temptation. Praise the Lord. So Joseph went through what he went through because he had a bigger dream as a shepherd boy. He has a bigger dream. So whatever situation you are going through is a process processing you to the accomplishment of your vision. It's a process processing you to the accomplishment of your vision. Remember, Jesus has a vision. He has a dream to save the whole world. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. So Jesus, his mission, his goal was to save the world. To gain the whole world. It was a bigger mission. Praise the Lord. And there was a great temptation. For all that temptation, they were the cause to the accomplishment of his vision. Praise God. So whatever you're going through is a cause to the accomplishment of your vision. It's a cause. It's a process. It's a doorway. It's a doorway to the accomplishment of your vision. So they hated Joseph, that's the very verse, and his brethren said to him, shall thou indeed reign over us? So as a shepherd boy, Joseph saw himself already reigning. Remember at creation, when God created you, he said, go and dominate, go and reign. So you must know that that is who you are. And when you know that, you don't need to settle for anything lesser than that. And they hated him yet the more for his dream and for his words. Look at verse 9. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren. So the fact that they kept hating him did not stop him from dreaming. Praise God. The fact that they were against him, the fact that they asked him, does it mean that we are going to bow before you? Does it mean that you are going to reign over us? And then they hated him. When you talk of hatred, you know when someone hates someone. These people hated Joseph so much so that they wanted to kill him. They threw him into the pit, remove him, and sold him as a slave. So they had a level of hatred. You know, they hated Joseph so much. But that did not stop Joseph from doing what? From dreaming. Hallelujah. Amen. I have come to encourage you this morning. This part of your breakthrough, don't allow anything to stop you from having your dream.
Amen.
It doesn't matter the position you are now, what the world says you are now, what the economic system says you are now. Praise God.
Amen.
Your dream is not determined by the economic system. Although there is crisis, you still need to see yourself big. Praise God.
Amen.
Although you have been hated, rejected, segregated in this land, you need to see yourself as big above them. Praise God.
Amen.
Don't allow their attitude to limit you or put you back. Don't allow people's behavior around you to put you back. Praise God. You need to dream. It's very important. Because it is this dream that will give you a drive. So Joseph told the dream to his father. And his father was also surprised. Does it mean that myself and your mother will come and other nations will come and bow before you? So Joseph kept dreaming and kept confessing. Praise God. And he kept confessing, this is who I am. So when you have your dream, you must begin to speak the dream to yourself. You must begin to speak it upon yourself. Keep on speaking your dream. Keep on speaking your vision. Keep on talking to your vision. And he will obey you. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So Joseph had this dream. But there were a lot of challenges. However, he never submitted to one. I don't know the challenges you are going through because of your dream. But I've come to encourage you this morning. Don't surrender to any of them.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Don't surrender to any of them. Now, let us try to examine some driving force, some factors that can enable you to focus, to have focus, and eventually attain your dream or your goal. Praise God. What are some of the force to put in place? What are some forces to put in place? Amen. One, the first force to implore is you must be able to identify your dream. You must be able to do what to identify your dream. You must be conversant to your dream. You must know your dream very well. You must know how it looks like. You must know the size of your dream. You must know the weight of your dream. You must know the color of your dream. And you must know the height of your dream. Praise God. So in another word, if God show you this flower with this color, you must be able to notice this flower very well, master this flower very well, master the color of this flower very well. There's a reason for that. I'm going to show you in a minute. Praise God. Because if you don't know, why do you need to identify your dream? Why do you need to master your dream? You need to master your dream because the devil counterfeit dreams. Hello?
Hi.
Is the congregation with me?
Yes.
The devil counterfeit dreams. No, there are sometimes God show you something. God show you your future. God show you your destiny. But the devil brings something similar. Hello?
Yes.
The devil will bring something similar. So if you don't have a mastery of what the Lord showed you, you will settle for what the devil will bring to you. Because the devil counterfeit every action of God in order to deviate the children of God. The devil counterfeit every action of God in order to deviate the children of God. So if you don't know the original of your dream, you will settle for the counterfeit. Praise God. Let's go to Genesis 39. Are we in?
Yes.
From verse 2. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. I think we are fasting. Are we not? Does the church, we don't have 3 days and a month fasting? I announced last week, yes.
Yeah, we ought to be fasting, not to be drinking water.
I know it's wrong, but we need to fast. Praise God. Verse 3. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. Verse 4. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had he put into his hand. And it came to pass from the time that he had made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. Now, I want to show you something. Joseph saw himself as a ruler. He saw himself as people coming to bow to him. Are we understanding? Then, along the line, the devil brought another opportunity similar to that to Joseph. But Joseph did not see only servants. Or he did not see himself as a servant. Or a boss of servant. He saw himself and everybody in the nation were coming to bow before him. So when the devil brought this opportunity, Joseph, because he identified his dream, because he knew what he saw, because he knew what the Lord showed him, he refused to settle to it. Are we understanding? So sometimes we settle for less because we don't even know where we're going through. We don't even know what we saw. So we set it to something similar. Not every opportunity is an opportunity. There are some opportunity that the devil brings in order to block the bigger opportunity that is ahead. Praise the Lord. So had it been Joseph relaxed with Potiphar's wife in Potiphar's house, they wouldn't have put him into prison and maybe he would have remained there and died there as masters of slaves. But he was not supposed to be a master of slaves. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
He saw himself as a governor. Because the father asked him, does it mean that myself, my mother, and my mother, and other nations will come to bow before you? So what Joseph saw in his dream was nation coming to bow before him. That is what he saw. So when this opportunity came, he refused to remain there. He refused to embrace it because he knew where he was going to. So he could not miss his way. So many times we miss our way in life because we don't know our direction. We don't even know our destination. We cannot even identify what God has shown us. But that was not the case of Joseph. Praise God. So one of the forces to drive you to the accomplishment of your vision is identifying your vision, having a mastery of your vision. That's the first point. The second point, the ability to resist temptation and run away from sin. The ability to resist temptation and run away from sin. Once you have a vision, once you have a dream, there are bound to be temptation. And there will also be opportunity to fall into sin. And sin is a weight to your vision. Sin is a weight to your vision. Sin will blind your eyes from your vision, and sin will divide you from your vision. Praise the Lord. So you must have the ability to resist sin, to resist temptation, and run away from sin. Genesis, verse 39, verse 7 to 12. And it came to pass, listen to this, and it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, lie with me. But he refused and said unto his master's wife, behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he had committed all that he had to my hand. There is no greater in this house that I, neither had he kept back anything from me but thee. Because thou art his wife, how then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And it came to pass, as he spoke to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there with him. And she caught him by his garment, saying, lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. Praise God. So temptation came to Joseph. Opportunity to sin came to Joseph. But because he was a man of vision, there was ability in him to resist that temptation. A man of vision does not succumb to every temptation. Jesus was a man of vision. After 40 days in the wilderness, the devil showed up. So you must know that in any great dreams, there are great temptations on your way, and you need the ability to resist them. Because it is in the resistance of your temptation that will determine the achievement of your vision. So Jesus overcame, resisted temptation. Joseph resisted temptation and avoided sin. Peter says with the Hebrews that we need to resist sin to the shedding of our blood. So there is a need to resist sin. The moment you commit sin, the moment you settle with sinful life and sinful activities, you have already malfunctioned your vision. You have destroyed your vision. You have destroyed your vision. So Joseph refused to settle to that. Praise God. And that is the case with you this morning. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
I pray for you that God will give you the ability to resist sin, to run away from sin and resist temptation, so that your vision will be accomplished in Jesus' mighty name. Believe you me, we are still loitering around, we are still circulating because we don't have the ability to resist. We don't have the ability to resist. If you can resist the temptation on your way, if you can resist that sin, if you can talk away that sin, believe you me, you are on your way to the accomplishment of your vision. Praise God. The next point. You are required to glory in trials and tribulation. Right. You are required to glory in trials and tribulation, knowing that the Lord is with you in them. Huh? You are required. I'm talking of the force that will enable you to accomplish your vision. So, when you glory in trials and tribulation, not complaining or murmuring, you, when they come, you rejoice in them. Praise God. You glory in them. Let's see Genesis 39. We're seeing Genesis 39, 20 and 21. And Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound, and he was there in the prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keepers of the prison. So you see, Joseph did not start arguing. Joseph did not start resisting or start justifying himself. He surrendered to that temptation. Praise God. And he was happy to be chief of the prisoners. Why? Because he acknowledged that the Lord was with him. So you must glory in tribulation, recognizing the presence of God with you, knowing that you are not in it alone. Praise God. He said, for we have the high priest, we cannot be touched by the feelings of our infirmity, but was at all points tempted like as we are. So what, once we are going through trials, when we are going through difficulties, the Lord is with us in them. Amen. Now let's go to Romans. Let's somebody open Romans 5. Romans 5 from verse 2 to 5. Romans 5 from verse 2 to 5. Yes, let us handle the first reading. We read from there. Romans 5, verse 2 to 5.
By whom also we have access by faith into it, into this grace wherein we stand,
mm-hmm,
and rejoice in hope of glory of God.
Mm-hmm.
And not only so, but with glory in tribulation also.
So you see, we glory in tribulation also.
Knowing that tribulation worketh patience.
Now, so in tribulation, it worketh patience.
And patience, experience.
And in patience, there is experience.
And experience, hope.
And the experience brings hope.
And hope maketh not ashamed.
And the hope will never put you to shame.
Because the love of God is shed abroad.
Because the love of God is shed abroad.
In our heart by the Holy Ghost.
In our heart by the Holy Ghost.
Which is given. given unto us.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So in tribulation, patience, it will produce patience. Then patience will produce hope. So in every situation Joseph was in prison, he was patient. And there was still hope for the accomplishment of his vision. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Take note of the point I'm giving you. Then the next point, you must be determined. You must be determined. Identify distraction and be vigilant. This is a very important point I'm making. We're talking of determination there, because I don't want to make the one because of time. So I'm trying to comprise them. So you must be determined. You must be determined. Then be able to identify distraction and be vigilant. Praise the Lord. And be vigilant. Now, if you are not determined, if you cannot identify distraction, if you are not vigilant, you will be taken away from the pathway, from the whole way to the accomplishment of your mission. You will easily be thrown out. You will easily be knocked out. Now let us go to 2 Kings. Let me show you something in the book of 2 Kings. Am I making sense here?
Yes.
Hello?
Hi.
Am I making sense?
Yes.
Am I teaching somebody?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's go to 2 Kings. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. We don't have time to really digest it, but I just want to show you something there. Praise God. So I will read another point there and then we go forward. And it came to pass, this is not the story I said to you, the story I said you're going to miss it. And it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah into heaven by a wide way, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel. And Elijah said unto him, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophet that were at Bethel came forth to Elijah and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? And he said, yea, I know it. Hold your peace. So you see, Elisha, look up, please. Elisha wanted the double portion of Elijah anointing. But Elijah wanted to stop him. That you don't need to stress yourself. Stay here. I want to go. But Elisha was determined to go with Elijah. Elisha was determined to go with Elijah. And then along the way, distraction came. And distraction will come from those who are close to you. Distraction will come even from your brethren who are believers with you in the same church. If you are not careful, they will distract you. They will bring little gossip to distract you from your vision. So they came to gossip to Elisha. Do you know that the Lord will be taking your master today? He did not have time for them. He said, hold your peace. If we don't learn how to tell people to hold their peace, they will distract us from our vision.
Yes, sir.
This man was focused for what he wanted. No distraction. I don't need you. I don't need your advice. I don't need your consent. I don't need your gossip. Praise God. I don't need it. Because you know what you want. Elisha was Elijah that he wanted. And he was after it. He was determined to have it. Praise God. He was determined. And he could identify destruction when they came. And the destruction kept coming. He will keep reading. Because at every city that they entered, the sons of prophets. Now, what I want you to understand that these were sons of prophets, these were other junior prophets like Elisha. But they knew that Elisha was in for something very big. So they wanted to use gossip in order to distract him. Sometimes when you begin to function in a church, when you begin to function in the vineyard of God, and people start seeing the power of God in you, and people start seeing God lifting you up, they bring you into their clique. When you enter there, your vision dies. The power of God upon you dies. You become like them. Praise the Lord. Why? Because they don't want you to go forward. They don't want you to move. They don't want you to lead them. Let me tell you something. When you're at the same level with people, it's good. But by the time you make a step ahead, they rose against you in order to drag you back. Because they don't want to let you go. They don't want you to pass them. They don't want you to abandon them where they are. They don't want you to abandon them. Praise God. Okay, let us continue. I'm going to... Let me go down to verse 11 because I don't want to read all this about time. And it came to pass as they, when you go home, you can read all. And it came to pass as they still went on and thought that behold, they appeared. No, there's an important place that I want from verse 9. And it came to pass when they were gone over that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. Now, this one will require vigilance and sensitivity. Praise God. But remember, I did not partition them because the partitioning will be very long and will take us so much time. This one requires what? Vigilance and sensitivity. Now, there was determination, identifying of destruction. Now, you need to be vigilant and be sensitive. He said, if you will see me go, if you can see me go, then in another word, be on your guard. A man of vision is a man who is always on the guard, vigilant. You must have a discerning spirit. Praise God. Be vigilant. He said, if you shall see me go, then it shall be so unto you. Then he said, and it came to pass as they still went on and talked that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horse of fire and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a wide way into heaven, and Elisha saw it. You shall see it in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
I said you shall see it in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Because you will be vigilant, because you will be sensitive, you shall see it.
Yeah.
It shall come upon you.
Yeah.
You shall you shall acquire it.
Yeah.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Yeah.
You shall acquire it. And verse 11, verse 12, and Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel, and the horsemen thereof. And he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own cloak and rent them into two pieces. He took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and went back and stood by the bank of Jordan. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and smote the waters, and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he also had smitten the water, they parted thither and thither, and Elisha went over. And when the sons of the prophet which were to view at Jericho saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah does rest on Elisha. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves to the ground before him. Praise the Lord. I want somebody to put your hand together for Jesus Christ. Put your hand before Jesus Christ.